So I threw out all our pumpkins and all our mums this weekend. Fall is over, people. It's over. In the space of just 2 weeks this fall, Vice President Kamala Harris lost not one, but two of her senior aides. First, just before Thanksgiving, news broke that Ashley Etienne, Harris's communications director, would be leaving the vice president's office. Then, in early December, CNN reported that Symone Sanders, Harris's chief spokesperson and a senior advisor to the vice president, was also headed out the door. Harris allies quickly moved to explain both of these departures as long planned and not part of any sort of problem within the Veep's office. Quote, "It's natural for staffers who've thrown their heart and soul into a job to be ready to move on after a few years," said White House Press Secretary Jen Psaki when she was asked about Sanders leaving. Now, if you believe that, well, I've got a little video company called Blockbuster that I think you should invest in. It's really on the rise. Top advisors to a vice president do not just randomly leave less than a year into a term. One departure might be explained away by extenuating circumstances. Two, there's just no way. The decisions by Etienne and Sanders to head for the exits raises a simple but profound question. What is happening in Kamala Harris's political world? And while that question is relatively simple, the answer, or answers, are not. There are those who dispute even the premise of the question, insisting that Harris is being judged by an unfair standard because of her history-making status as the first woman, first African-American, and first Asian-American to hold the vice presidency. But staff departures at such a senior level so soon into a term would provoke questions no matter who was in the vice president's office because, well, they are odd and not at all typical. So again, I ask, what is going on? Now, we have some window into that via reporting by my CNN colleagues Edward Isaac Dovier and Jasmine Wright. The two of them wrote this, quote, "Interviews with nearly three dozen former and current Harris aides, administration officials, Democratic operatives, donors, and outside advisors who spoke extensively to CNN reveal a complex reality inside the White House. Many in the vice president's circle fume that she's not being adequately prepared or positioned and instead is being sidelined. The vice president herself has told several confidants she feels constrained in what she's able to do politically, and those around her remain wary of even hinting at future political ambitions, with Biden's team highly attuned to signs of disloyalty, particularly from the vice president," end quote. Now, when a politician is feeling stressed or believes they are not being used properly, they almost always exert pressure downstream of them on their senior staff. And reports of issues within Harris's VP staff are not exactly new. As far back as July, Politico reported that Harris's staff was, quote, "experiencing low morale, poorest lines of communication, and diminished trust among aides and senior officials," end quote. Now, that story laid much of the blame for her problems at the feet of Harris's chief of staff, Tina Flournoy. And Harris struggling with retaining staff is, well, not just a thing in her vice presidential office. Quote, "I didn't cover her closely in Sacramento, but I know she did churn through staff. Mark Barabak, a veteran Los Angeles Times political reporter, told me about Harris's time as California Attorney General, and he added that Harris had most trouble, quote, in the communications end of the operation," end quote. Now, it's worth noting here, the California Department of Justice paid $1.1 million in settlements to former Harris staffers in the AG's office to settle allegations of sexual harassment and retaliation during her time in office. A Harris spokesman said in 2019, when the settlements were revealed, that Harris did not know about them. Quote, "As the chief executive of a department of nearly 5,000 employees, the buck stopped with me," Harris said in a statement at the time, adding, "No one should face harassment or intimidation in the workplace, and victims of sexual misconduct should be listened to, believed, and protected," end quote. Now, Barabak, the Los Angeles Times reporter, has his own theory as to why Harris has struggled so mightily. It's just kind of part of the job. Quote, "Even as she shoulders an array of policy portfolios, even as she visits Paris this week seeking to address the administration's ruptured relations with France, it remains a fact that the number two job in the White House is inherently a diminishing one," he wrote in a column in mid-November. Later in that same piece, Barabak went on to write this, quote, "Virtually every vice president in modern history, save Dick Cheney, who played an unusually prominent role guiding defense and foreign policy under President George W. Bush, has looked smaller than when he or she accepted the position." He added this, "That's because a main job requirement is stepping away from the spotlight, except when cheerleading for the president and his agenda," end quote. I think all of that is right. But regardless of the reason, Harris is not anywhere near where she and her team hope to be as she finishes up her first year as vice president. And things, at least at the moment, appear to be getting worse, not better. And that is The Point. We make new Point episodes every Tuesday and Thursday. I hope you check them all out.